Love incarnate, love divine. Star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. No.
Today here at Tiger Covenant Church is all about Jesus Christ, God with us. Would you join me in prayer? Father God, we thank you so much that you are here. We thank you that your son came into the world to love us, to bring peace to the world. So we ask, oh God, that as we celebrate your presence on this special day, we ask, God, that your love would permeate our hearts and that we would walk in faith and that we would walk in truth. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Today is a special service and program here at Tiger Covenant Church. Many of you are joining us online. You're live streaming with us. And today is a special Christmas program. We have music, and I'm proud to announce to you that our special guest speaker is my good friend, Pastor Stephen Blixstad, and I'll be introducing him later on. But enjoy yourself. Sit back. Our broadcast, our live stream today is going to be a little bit longer than we normally do because it's a Christmas special program. So enjoy. Now we're going to have the Advent reading, the fourth Sunday of Advent, and Joni and George Kluman are going to lead us in the reading.
Thank you, Pastor. The first Sunday in Advent, we lit the prophet candle that symbolized long-held hope of Jesus' arrival. Next came the Bethlehem candle to remind us that God appeared in a humble manger, honoring the poor that Jesus would save. The third candle was the shepherd's candle, reflecting the shepherd's joyous response to the angel choir's song of good news. Today, we light the fourth candle in the Advent wreath, the angel's candle, symbolizing peace on earth and goodwill toward all that we receive through the birth of the Christ child in Bethlehem. Today's lectionary scripture tells of another angel, one that appeared to Joseph in a dream to confirm that Jesus' birth was from God, from Matthew 1:18. Now, this is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph, but while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her fiancé, being a just man, decided to break the engagement quietly so as not to disgrace her publicly. As he considered this, he fell asleep, and an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. "Joseph, son of David," the angel said, "do not be afraid to go ahead with your marriage to Mary, for the child within her has been conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All of this happened to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. "Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel," meaning God is with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord commanded. He brought Mary home to be his wife. Dear God, please bless us at this time as we thank you for the greatest, incredible gift, the baby Jesus.
Would you join us as we worship the Lord this morning?
anything I do, more than anything I say, more than anything I say or do, I worship you. More than any card I write, more than any Christmas light I light, more than any gift I give, I'll give you my praises from morning to night.
I bow
to worship you this Christmas day. I'll stand and say, glory, glory, the highest giving shows this day. Oh, I bet you celebrate the meaning of this holiday, giving praises to the beauty of your holy name.
More than anything I do, more than anything I say, more than anything I say or do, I worship you. More than any card I write, more than any Christmas light I light, more than any gift I give, I give you my praises from morning till night.
We worship you, Lord. We bless your name. You're wonderful, Lord. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ is the Lord.
Well,
and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloth, lying in a manger."
Your life.
precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, rescue the souls of men.
Savior. He's a wonderful friend. He is so worthy of all of our praise this morning, Lord. We bless you. We love you. We worship and honor you. We celebrate your birth with reverent awe, but with a joy because we know that you came to save. And we're so grateful for that. I lift my hands in total adoration to you. You reign on the throne, for you are God and God alone. Because of you, my cloudy days are gone. I can sing to you this song. I just want to say that I love you more than anything.
I lift my hands.
Step down from heaven. Humbly,
Let's sing that one more time. Adore.
Adore. Come let us adore. Come let us adore Him.
The Lord.
Worship Christ the Lord. Let all that is within us adore.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much. We adore you tonight. We bless your name. You are such a good God, and we love you. We ask that you bless your word to our hearts as we hear from you and as your servant speaks. Bless Pastor Steve. We love him, and we love your word, and we ask that you would be front and center in our hearts, and this Christmas season, we would embrace you more and love our neighbor more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's my pleasure, it's my honor to introduce a friend. Pastor Steve is pastor of the Trinity Community Church here in Tigard, and we've known each other over 10 years. And Steve, I just want to tell you how much you mean to me. And as you get ready to present the word, I'll be cheering you on, praying for you. And Steve has done two things that has impressed me so much, and I look forward to hearing the word. But in addition to presenting the word to you today, Steve has been a friend. Over the years, we broke bread together, we've shared. We don't always agree on everything, but we're connected by the blood of Jesus. And the one thing I appreciate about you, Steve, is that many times you've just picked up the phone, you've called me and said, David, how are you doing? And you prayed for me. And for that, I'm eternally grateful. We all welcome Pastor Steve. Love you, bro.
I hope it's okay if I take my mask off. At my church on Sunday mornings, I wear a face shield, and every time that I'm done speaking, I kind of have to throw it away or put it aside because I see there's all kinds of stuff on it. But I appreciate the honor to be here today, David, Pastor David. I love you as well, and we have broken bread together. I know we spent one time at the Global Leadership Summit together for 2 days and had lunch, and then with Conquest 2019, joining you there that whole day. I have to tell you, I love his laugh. You love his laugh, right? He's just, he's got such a genial personality and joy in his heart. And I have loved him. And I know that I am now a real friend because I'm here on Christmas, the fourth Sunday of Advent, preaching at his church. That is just crazy. I would never allow someone to preach that Sunday. That's like the biggest day of the year, and here he's got me here. So, David, Pastor David, you rock. So, and I know you already know that, people. So, I have a story to tell you before I preach, but I'm also going to be reading the scripture, and so I'm going to have to kind of rush through all this. But it's a story that's sort of familiar, at least in some way, to the story that we're going to hear. It's a different angel, it's a different place, it's a different time, it's different circumstances, but there's some similarities to it. And back in 2011, I'm thinking maybe 2010 possibly, I was in my office and I heard a knock on my front door. And I came out of my office and I turned the corner and there's a man standing at the front of the church. And he has, much like me today, a little bit dressier than this, but he had a full suit, he had on a tie, and he had really nice dress shoes, and he had a book in his hand, and he's at the front door, and he's got this huge smile on his face, and I thought, oh no, it's a salesperson. And I thought, I don't, you know, but I've kind of committed myself at the church especially to not be rude to people that come to the church, because that's not a really good statement about a pastor if you're rude to somebody. So I open the door and he comes in, and clearly he has an accent. And so we go into my office and we just start chatting, and I find out his name is Laurent. And I hope I'm saying that as well as I can. It's a French name, Laurent. And from his accent and from the fact that he's very dark skinned, I know that he's an African, or he's from Africa. And so it turns out that he's moved to the neighborhood, just an apartment complex just less than a half mile from our church. And he was checking out churches because we were the closest church to where he lived. And so, but as it came time, we began to talk about Jesus. And from that moment on, it is like this person just became an instant friend. We shared and we talked for probably a good, maybe half hour, hour, and we just talked. And I wasn't sure, you know, if he thought this was going to be a place that he would ever come to or what he thought. But in the midst of the conversation, we're just about ready to end it, it seems. He says to me, "Pastor Steve," and I wish I could imitate how he said it. It's just, you know, I don't even want to try because I'll butcher it. But it was so endearing, but he says, "I see the Holy Spirit on you." And it really threw me for a loop because, I mean, it's not like anyone has never said something along those lines, but this was just kind of out of the blue, and he didn't know me at all, really. And as we'll read in the story today, Mary asked the angel when he tells her what's going to happen. She says to him, "How can that be?" And I didn't say those words or think those words exactly, but that was the sentiment that was going on in my mind. How can that be? But in that comment and in that thought, something was birthed within me. Something changed in my heart. Something changed in the way in which we began to run and activate in our church. Laurent was at our church for 9 months. And for me, that's really symbolic for new birth. Laurent, as he would meet with me and he would be at prayer meeting and I would drive him home or we would go out to lunch together, it was almost as if Laurent was my pastor, not the other way around. He was so godly. He loved Jesus so much. He was so charismatic, and he had so much love for people. It was unbelievable. So as I think about this story, the reason I say that is because Laurent was an angel to me. He had come to me at a time when we had just experienced the great loss of many of our young families because we were trying to minister to street people, to people that were coming off addictions and all kinds of physical problems, and not just alcohol, but drugs, meth, heroin. And that scared my people. And so as I sat in my office that day, I was a struggling and discouraged pastor. But Laurent was an angel. Angel means messenger. So as we think about this story today, I want you to think of me maybe as a messenger to you today. That God has a message for you to speak to your heart today. That maybe you're discouraged, maybe you're troubled, maybe you are struggling with certain things. But you need to see what the angel talked to Mary about. This story that I'm going to read is not just the story about Mary. It's a story about God and his love for us. It's a story that also intersects in our lives today as we read it, as we think about it, as we meditate on it, as we try to activate it in our lives. It's a message for us, for you, for me, for all of us, for the church. And so it's from the Gospel of Luke in chapter 1, and I'll just read a little bit of it at a time. But it is a powerful story that we hear in the Luke Gospel, Luke's Gospel. It starts out in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. Elizabeth was Mary's cousin. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town of Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. Greetings, you who are highly favored. That's kind of what I felt like when Laurent said that to me. I see the Holy Spirit on you. The Lord is with you, he's saying to Mary. Have you ever wondered why God chose Mary? I've thought about it a lot this season, and I have no answer for you, and so you're just going to have to think with me or be confused or have it be mysterious to you, but I don't think it's that she is so much better than anyone else that could have been Mary. I know the Catholic Church probably has a position on this that they've developed over the decades or centuries or even two millennia, but I propose to you today that Mary is not much different than you or me. Because you think about it in the Bible, and we don't have time to go through all the cases, but there's many times that an angel would come to someone in the Old Testament, and even it happened just before this with Zechariah, Elizabeth's husband, that an angel came to him and he was scared out of his gourd, as my family would say. He was scared to death. And the angel said, "Zechariah, do not be afraid." And he asked a similar question that Mary asked, "How can this be?" He was troubled just as Mary was troubled. But those words that, and we don't see it so much in this passage, but that word greetings, if you go back to the original word, it actually means rejoice, and it's a command to Mary. So he's saying, "Rejoice, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." I have to admit, when Laurent said that, I didn't really believe him, but I wanted to believe it. And I'm sure Mary is feeling much the same way. And yet she's feeling, not rejoicing, she's feeling troubled. That word troubled is the only time it's used in the New Testament, at least in that context, in that specific version of the word. But the root word is used many other times, and it's used with Herod, who found out from the Magi that Jesus was going to be, or was the king of the Jews, was already born. And it says in Matthew 2, "Where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. Same similar root word. It troubled, disturbed. Mary was disturbed. The irony of this story is that Mary's life was disrupted. It was disturbed and troubled. Not only by Herod himself when he sent people to kill babies in Bethlehem. The angel of the Lord told Joseph and Mary and the baby to go into Egypt to flee, and they were troubled. They were refugees in Egypt. They were troubled. Mary was troubled when she was impregnated by the Holy Spirit, and everybody around her assumed that she had been unfaithful to Joseph and looked on her with shame. Joseph himself, her husband-to-be at the time, didn't even believe her. He was going to divorce her and put her aside quietly, righteously, but he didn't believe her. Until the angel told him, "Don't take her to be your wife. What is born in her has been conceived by the Holy Spirit," as we heard today in that Advent reading. Mary was troubled. Being highly favored does not mean that your life is going to be easy. She faced even much more trouble, even as Jesus' life. And even when Jesus was presented as a baby to the temple, Simeon said to her, "Your soul, your very own soul will be pierced as well." Mary was troubled. And just like all those other characters in the Old Testament that experienced angels or had some revelation from God, many great leaders, Moses and Elijah, who in James says was just like you and me, that Mary is just like you and me. So I don't want us to see this story and say, well, that was great for Mary, but this passage is for you and me today. Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. And that's true if you have received Jesus by faith, that he is the Savior of the world. Our song, our church has begun singing in COVID a song that's fairly new, but I think it's gone around the world, and it's called The Blessing. I thought maybe tonight or today that there would be that song that we might see it, and I go, wow, God, you're so amazing. But he picked some other great songs. That one by Selah, man, my favorite song. You guys rocked it. I was already in tears sitting over there by Pastor David listening to that song. But this song says in the first stanza, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. That's what God wants for you to hear today, that the Lord thinks of you as highly favored. He wants you to know that he is with you, that he's for you, that he's behind you, he's before you, he's all around you, he's within you, he is for you. The second thing the angel says to Mary is, do not be afraid. It doesn't say she was afraid, but just by the fact that he said that to her, he knew that she was fearful. She was not only troubled, she was fearful. You have found favor with God. It goes on in verses 31 to 33. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. What we see here is that God is fitting. He's told Mary she's blessed, she's highly favored, that God is with her. But now he's telling her, I have a plan for you. I have a future for you. And it's not just to bless you, it's to bless the whole world. God is fitting her life, her story, into his bigger story of sending his son to establish an everlasting kingdom to redeem humanity and actually all of creation from the bondage of sin and decay and darkness and death. That story or that passage we often read at Christmas time in our church, and probably you do too, from Isaiah, it says, nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were distressed. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. The people walking in distress, in darkness, have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. He came to bring, through Mary, the greatest gift to all of humanity, the light of the world, the light of God, the light of Christ. And then in Psalm 89, 1 to 4, he talks about the Lord's great love that's forever. That's going to establish his line forever and make your throne firm throughout all generations. He was going to use Mary not only to bless her, but to be a blessing to others. Mary asked, how can this be? How will this be? How is this even possible? Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail. How is this going to happen? How are you going to be blessed? How are you going to be a blessing? Just like Mary was, through the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life. We have a Tuesday morning devotional time, and I don't even lead it. I have a lay person. He's an awesome guy. He does the devotional. He's doing a devotional out of Psalm 91. And it's not a psalm that I've particularly liked in the past. Partly, I won't even go into that, but it's not been my favorite. But as we have been studying a verse every week, it's starting to become one of my favorite scriptures. And as I was thinking about this and all the things that we've just talked about, I want to read it to you. I'm memorizing it, but I don't trust myself to remember all the words, so I'm going to read it to you. But it gives so much emphasis to the fact of trusting in God. It says, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. That sounds so much like what the angel told Mary. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. And the power of the Most High will overshadow you. The second phrase or main phrase of that song, the blessing, talks about more than just that He's going to make His face shine upon us and give us peace. But it goes like this. He says, may His favor be upon you. And 1,000 generations to your children, excuse me, to your family and your children and their children and their children. God has called us to be blessed, but then to bless everyone around us, our families, our children, and it's meant to be for everyone. Pastor David gave me the scriptures that you guys read for the Book of Common Prayer and that he uses to preach out of. And one of them was from Romans 16, and I won't read it. But it just talked about how God, the gospel that Paul is sharing, the gospel, he calls it my gospel, but I don't think he means that in the sense that we might take it in our day. But he talks about the gospel so that all the Gentiles might come to the obedience of faith. God wants us to be a blessing to all the creation, all of humanity, to know Jesus, the Savior, the Son of David, the Son of the Most High, the Son of God. And when we receive Him by faith, when we put our trust in Him, when we dwell in the shelter of the Almighty, we will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. We do that through believing and trusting Jesus and then receiving the Holy Spirit to be with us. The last thing that Mary says is, I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled. I read that same verse in the Message Bible. It's more of a paraphrase than a translation, but I use it as the title for this sermon. Let it be with me just as you say. That was the prayer of my heart as Laurent told me that he said he saw the Holy Spirit upon me. Even when I didn't necessarily believe it, that was my prayer, Lord, because that had been the longing of my heart. I'm sure it's the longing of many of your hearts, that you want, when people look at you, to say, there's something different about you. I recognize a peace. I recognize a joy. I recognize a hope. I recognize some power and authority that goes beyond what I can understand. And when you receive Jesus by faith, and when you receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit, those are the things that are going to exude from your life. You will be blessed, but you will be a blessing to others. May it be with me just as you say, God. Just as the angel said to Mary. Just as I believe he is saying to you today. Do you believe in Jesus, the Son of the Most High? I pray that those who are listening this morning can say, yes, I believe in Jesus. And the Bible says when we receive Jesus, we receive the Holy Spirit. It doesn't mean you're filled with the Holy Spirit in a sense. You may have been filled, but you're not activating the fullness of the Spirit. Maybe you haven't given him all of your life yet. But I want you to think, if you believe in Jesus, do you believe he really highly favors you? And that he's with you? We're going through some tough times. Do you believe that God is with you and that you're actually favored? It doesn't mean that you're not going to have distress or trouble. It just means that you have the joy and the peace of God in the midst of those troubles. Do you believe his favor includes being a servant of God? In submission to him so that you can not only be a blessing, but be a blessing to others. Your family, your children, your neighbors, your co-workers, your fellow churchgoers. Just by the way, we are the church as followers of Jesus. We don't go to church, we are the church. But are you seeking to bless others and to further his kingdom? So I just have a few suggestions to read, to memorize, to meditate on his word. It's a way to hear from God. It's a way to have him speak to you and tell you things he wants you to know. And then be submissive to what God says. When you hear what he says, that you're submissive to it. You're actually going to put it into practice. You know, I read a bunch of stuff every day. And in fact, I think I've decided I'm going to quit reading so many devotionals because I start reading too many and I get them all confused. And I need to hear a message from God today. And I'm not going to get it from four. I'm going to get it from one or two. But I'm not just going to hear it with my ears, but I want to hear it with my heart. And I want to then put it into practice. What word from God do you need to submit to him today? What has he told you that you're resisting still? And then be filled with the Spirit. It's simply asking. Luke tells us just to ask. Just like a father wouldn't give his kids something bad to eat or dangerous if they ask for something, for a fish or for a piece of bread. He's not going to give them a scorpion. He's not going to give them something that's going to harm them. How much more will your Father in heaven give you the Holy Spirit if you ask? Just ask him to come. And then to just walk with confidence that you are walking in the favor of God as you pray with him, as you are in constant prayer and conversation with him, or even just being with him. You don't even have to have words, but you're his. And he wants you to bless others. So that's all I got. But I think it's pretty good stuff. Not because of my words, because of what Mary heard from the angel, what God wants to speak to you today. You're highly favored. God is with you. You have found favor with him. He doesn't want you to be afraid. He doesn't want you to be troubled. He wants you to be blessed and to be a blessing. Let me pray. Father, thank you for today. Lord, I just feel so blessed to be here. I've been blessed by the music. I've been blessed by the readings. I've been blessed by my brother David. Blessed just by seeing the smiles and the head nodding of the people here today. Father, I pray that those who are watching online would sense that your presence is here with us. But not only with us, but with them in the very room in which they are watching this, that you highly favor them and that you want them to know Jesus. You want them to receive the Holy Spirit. Lord, I know that it's a simple decision of our will. Lord, I think of the three words that help us to come to know you. I'm sorry, Lord, I've gone my own way. Thanks for making a way back to the Father through Jesus. And please come into my life. Lord, I just ask that any out here or any here today, if they don't know you, they would just pray those three words in a prayer to you, asking for you to come into their life. And that you will honor your word. You're faithful to your promises. And for that, we thank you and praise you. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, in whom we love and who loves us. Amen.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you. Thank you for that word. You know, I sense God has touched our hearts. He's touched my heart. Some of us think we're not worthy, like Mary did. And then Mary, by the end of the exchange with the angel, she said, "May it be unto me as you have spoken." And I sense some of you have said that prayer with Pastor Steve, and you're saying yes to God. You're saying, "God, I accept what you say about my life, that you forgive me and you have something for me to do." Mary had been given a precious assignment. So I want you to go out this week and walk in the light of God's love and let his love permeate your day and permeate everyone that you come in contact with. Let's be faithful like Mary was. She's one of the great heroines of the Bible. She is my hero. Because she said, "Let it be unto me as you have said." So let's, by faith, as a church, as a faith community around the world, it starts here in the Northwest. Let us say, "God, what you say, I'm going to do." Thank you for joining in today. We're going to have one more song from the choir, our Tigard Covenant Worship Team Choir. And I'm excited, getting ready to hear the song. And it's going to be a great song. You're going to be blessed. And they're going to close it out. And before they do, I just want to ask you to continue to support the ministry of Tigard Covenant Church. If you're a member or a friend of Tigard Covenant Church, please continue to give. You can give on our church website, and we have a slide up right now telling you how you can give. You can give through PushPay, or you can give by sending your check or money order to our church offices, and we have a secured locked mailbox. Thank you so much I ask you for the rest of the year to be faithful in your study of God's word. This coming Tuesday night, we have a Bible study and prayer, and I'm excited to share with you that one of our attendees to our weekly Bible study online and when we're meeting in person is a young lady by the name of Haley Holton, and Haley is going to be leading our Bible study this Tuesday night. So come on in and tap in and join in. We'll send you a link with an email address this week letting you know how you can do that. You're going to be blessed. I'll be on. Several of our leaders will be on. Join us this Tuesday. And then starting in the new year, starting in 2021, we're starting a new all-church six-week series, a Bible study series, and a sermon series on the subject Unite. And it's a wonderful curriculum that God has blessed our denomination with. And we're using it. It's very biblically based, and we'll be preaching sermons and doing a weekly Bible study, a Zoom Bible study, on the theme of unite. More than ever, as Christians, we need to unite around the person of Jesus Christ through the precious Holy Spirit. Well, you have a wonderful day. God bless you. And we're going to end it with the song. Deborah, take us away. Thank you, thank you.
Come, let us adore Him, kneel down before Him, worship and adore Him. Come, let us adore Him. Worship and adore.